Hi, my name is Marty Ryan, and I'm the director of Love Your Gut Seminars. And this video is going to be an exploration of the small and the large intestines. Occasionally, I will be calling these particular tubes small and large bowel or small and large intestine. So if you hear either of those words, just consider them synonymous for this lecture. Small intestine first. Small intestine is about 16 to 20 feet long. And as we've been exploring the abdomen, we know that the stomach is located here. The end of the stomach, also called the pyloric sphincter, is located approximately here. So our landmarks to find the sphincter, xiphoid process, navel, two-thirds of the way from navel towards the xiphoid. So right there, I feel a distinct, thick, smooth muscle band around the tube. Okay, so that smooth muscle band manages movement of material from the stomach into the duodenum. So there and there. It's kind of like there's the sphincter, there's the end of the tube, the sphincter releases, the tube opens, sphincter closes, tube closes, like that. So officially, the duodenum is the beginning of the small intestine. And in this particular video, we're going to explore the jejunum and the ileum. So in another lecture, we've already explored the duodenum and talked about contributions from the gallbladder, contributions from the pancreas, contributions of food material from the stomach. A lion's share of our chemical digestion happens in the duodenum. And now, in the jejunum and the ileum, we're looking at absorbing macronutrients into our bloodstream. So there are loops of small bowel or small intestine back and forth filling up this space, all the way over to here, all the way down to here, and pretty much on the right side about here. What we've got on this side is the large intestine, so they're not occupying the same space at the same time. But so from here to here, here to here, that's our small intestine, much larger than people think. So now I'm going to palpate through the belly wall and just notice some of the tubes, some of the loops of his small intestine. And they're numerous. Pretty much wherever I put my hand, I'm rolling through and palpating over a distinct tube. That's great. Excellent. There's another loop right there. There's another loop right there. There's another loop right there. And again, I can't tell you exactly how the tube is oriented other than that it's back and forth, back and forth, finishing at the cecum. Now again, the cecum is this bank. This is the first bag of the large intestine. It sits here. It's anterior. And it's basically a collection of waste from the small intestine. What didn't get absorbed as our fuel gets moved into the large bowel, which is then eliminated. So cecum is wide. Ascending colon is a little narrower. And as we proceed through the large intestine, the tube gets narrower and narrower. So I'm just going to palpate the ascending colon. Here's the medial edge. Here's the lateral edge. And I'm squeezing the tube like that. So So that's the ascending colon. At some point underneath the ribs, it turns. It's anchored by ligaments to the diaphragm. Transverse colon going this way. So to find the transverse colon, I should find my landmarks again. Xiphoid, navel. 1/3 of the way, approximately, is where the transverse colon hangs and crosses the midline. So right about here, I've just landed on the front surface or the anterior surface of the tube. If I want to find the superior surface and the inferior surface, I need to go a little higher and a little lower and fence with this hand and hug with this hand, or fence and hug. That's great. And now I can follow the transverse colon till I run out of space at his rib margin, or run out of space at his rib margin. So I get to palpate a good chunk of his transverse colon. The rest of it is heading under the rib and turning next to the spleen. Because the large intestine functions as a water reclaimer, the material that's in the cecum is fairly watery. By the time that material gets over to here, it's not very watery anymore, and it's resembling more like stool. So water can make sharp turns. Solid material can only make sort of shallow, wide turns. So that's why the splenic flexure is so posterior and the turn is so wide. So now I'm going to lift and hug the descending colon by reaching over, lifting, and hugging. So there's the back side of the descending colon. There's the front side of the descending colon. And I'm just giving it a little squeeze. There we go. The sigmoid colon should be the easiest to palpate. I'm going to just pull this down just a little bit. There's the ASIS. The sigmoid colon is sitting in the left lower quadrant. And I'm just rolling over the tube at this point. And I'm going to lift it in just a moment. So it's anterior. It's very clear because there's material inside of it. So the signature of the tube is actually very clear. Whereas over here, it's less clear. It's more fluidy on this side, more solid on this side. There we go. Great. At some point, most pelvises, both males and females, make a little turn for the sigmoid colon. So I'm just going to palpate this model's belly and see where his sigmoid colon heads. Okay, his is flattening a little bit and then it's going to turn. So here is the inside of the tube. There is the outside of the tube. Inside of the tube, outside of the tube, inside of the tube, thank you, outside of the tube. Great. And that's about as much of the sigmoid colon as I can palpate. It's going behind the bladder to the rectum.